Hi everyone, and welcome back to part five, which is the last part of this lecture. So in this part, I'll mostly give you examples of some active research gravitating around the estimation of heritability. And this is mostly research that has been done on estimating heritability using individual level data. There is much more active research happening in the sphere of estimation of heritability, genetic correlation, and some of the biological insights we can gain from that using GWAS summary statistics. And that will be covered in the lecture given by Dr. Hilary Funicane. So the list of topics I've just mentioned here, I'm just going to go through each of them briefly. This is not a comprehensive list. This is a few things that I found interesting, but I think you don't hesitate to watch the space and reach out to me during the workshop if you want me to discuss a bit more specific aspects through emails or in the Slack channel. So I think I haven't emphasized it in the lecture, but estimation of additive genetic variance or heritability can be computationally burdensome, in particular when we have to manipulate large samples. When we have with the advent of biobanks like the UK Biobank and other biobanks with more than 100,000 participants, an inference of heritability using traditional techniques that I talked about, GRML or HE regression, can become challenging. So HE regression still works fairly well at large scale, and I think that's because it's by essence it's a very simple method that looks at regression. So even in the case when we have multiple GRMs, it's just transforming. The problem is essentially fitting a multivariate linear regression, which is almost instantaneous, right? Once we read the data, we can produce essentially the estimate. The issue with HE regression is that, at least in comparison with GRML, is that it can produce large standard errors, in particular when we have a large number of GRMs that we want to fit. So there has been a lot of effort in combining, in coming up with methods that are computationally efficient and yet produce estimators that are more statistically efficient in terms of having smaller standard errors than HE regression, for example. And so a lot of research has happened in that sphere. And I think, as biobanks continue to grow, I feel like there is still things to be done in that area. So think about it as your, if you want to invest the space, there is a few things to be done there. Another example is about incorporating biological information, in particular functional annotation. So I said, as I was describing in part four, some of the biases in heritability estimation, in particular coming from LD and MAF heterogeneity between SNPs in the GRM and the causal variance. But there, the SNPs can have more attributes. There's not just MAF and LD, they can have functional annotations. And we can essentially quantify the enrichment of heritability in those functional annotations. So this has been done in individual level data and has completely taken off with summary statistics method, which Hilary Funicane will cover in her lecture. But I think there is still, as we have, if we have efficient computational method for individual level inference combined with biological information, and that can bring some more new insights which we cannot grasp at the moment. So there is a lot of research happening in that area as well. So the third example is an estimation of non-additive genetic variants. And so this is, I'll take the time here to underline one limitation of this lecture, of the content of this lecture, is that I for clarity, for the sake of clarity, I only consider models of, you know, the effect of genes that are additive, right? Now in when I was describing in part three, I was describing the G part in the G model behind the GRML, you know, the sort of the reasoning in terms of fitting all the SNPs together. This was based on the assumption that the SNP effects are all additive. And so this assumption in reality can be violated because genetic architecture can involve non-additive genetic effect, in particular dominance effects. And so I think I'm not going to open a new chapter here. I just want to underline two things. One is that there is a limitation in what I've talked about. I think what we can capture using this standard method that I described here are essentially just the contribution of additive genetic effect, or the contribution of additive effect to heritability. But there is another part of research that can be done to also use similar machineries as the GRML machinery or the HE regression machinery to also quantify non-additive genetic effect and non-additive genetic variance. And so this is a few recent research has been published in this area. And just, you know, to give away some of the conclusions that we find is that there is actually little evidence of the contribution from dominance variants for a large number of complex traits. So the fourth example is something that we start to look into, say we as the field and we in particular as people in my lab, is to look at the estimation of SNP-based heritability using whole genome sequence data. In particular, as a way to answer the question is, where is the still missing heritability and to which extent the still missing heritability is contained in those rare and ultra rare variants that we could not access before using just SNP arrays and imputation strategies. So this is an active area of research and where there's still a lot of question marks and which will probably vary from traits to traits. And I think it's an exciting area to investigate. And finally, there's also things, you know, some research happening around the impact of non-random mating, in particular of assortative mating on heritability estimates. So briefly, assortative mating is when in the population, people select their partners or spouses based on the phenotypic similarity with themselves. And so this has been documented for a number of traits like stature, height, body mass index, political preferences, or educational attainment. And this is happening, and that kind of violate some assumptions about the independence of SNP effects that we are making in this in some of those models, like the GRML model, or to some to, it's, it comes as more like an implicit assumption in the HE regression model. And so the impact of that assortative mating on heritability estimate hasn't been known, at least until recently. And so there's some active research happening, including some of the faculties of the workshop. So if you are interested in that as well, feel free to reach out and we can have a conversation on the Slack channel about some of the exciting research happening there. So this is the last slide of this lecture. I hope that you've learned a lot in this lecture. If you have any question, there will be ways to talk about it and to follow up and make sure that everything that we're trying to convey is well received. So thank you very much for your attention again, and hope to see you in the practical. Cheers.